Okay, so Google have finally released their Gemini model. In this video, I'm going to have a look at some of the key things about the Gemini suite of models, look at some of the things in the technical paper that are really interesting, and also go through how this is different than some of the other models that are out there. Okay, so first, the major thing that separates the Gemini models from models that have come before is that these are really fully multimodal models, meaning that they're trained with inputs of not only text and images, but also videos and audio added in there as well. And they also have the ability to output both images and text here. So this really opens up a whole bunch of new opportunities that we haven't seen in large language models before. While a number of companies have done things where they've added vision to a language model or added different abilities to a language model, perhaps for robotics, etc. This shows you the concept of actually training a model like this from scratch on a huge amount of data. And you can imagine this is where Google has a big advantage, having YouTube, that they're able to train on a lot of videos from YouTube. They're able to train on a lot of audio signals that they've got. And all of this combined with the image data of charts, screenshots, PDFs, videos, etc., allow them to have a model that can take in a wide variety of inputs and allow it to learn from those inputs, not just text alone with something else added onto it later on. So it seems when they're training this model, they actually have different types of tokens based on the different kinds of input, whether that's audio, whether that's text, whether that's images or videos going into this. In some ways, this could be seen as being a bit like the paper Gatto that DeepMind did quite a while ago, where they basically trained on having special tokens for different type of modality inputs. Though it does seem here that this has been taken to a whole new level. Okay, so if we look at the model architectures, we can see that they have three model architectures in here. That's the Ultra being the biggest model, the Pro being the sort of main workhorse model, and the Nano models, which are the two small models. So actually there are four models currently. And my guess is that there will be many others that are fine tunes of the various base models of these sizes. So not surprisingly, the Ultra is very big and is the one that has been trained for a long time on TPUs. One of the things that is really surprising about the Ultra's training, though, is that it was trained on TPU version 4 hardware. But it seems this model perhaps started training, or for a variety of different reasons, has been trained on the TPU version 4s in here. So another thing that got lost, I think, in the big announcements today is that Google actually also announced that they're releasing a new version of TPUs out there. And these TPUs are substantially better than what the TPU 4 is. Remembering that Gemini Ultra has been trained on TPU 4s, not these brand new TPU 5s. When you look at the training rates for these new TPU 5s, they're 2.8 times better than what the Gemini Ultra was trained on. So this has got to make you think that there's a lot of new stuff that's coming around the corner next year for this as well. Unfortunately, Google's not telling us the size of the Ultra model or the Pro model, which is not very surprising. People don't really want to reveal the size of these models out there. One of the things that they do mention, though, is that for the training set, they're using something along the lines of the chinchilla scaling for this. So the chinchilla scaling comes from a paper out of DeepMind, and it works out to be roughly around 20, 21 times the number of parameters is the number of tokens that you want to train on. So you could imagine that if this model is around 800 billion parameters, you're looking at around 16 to 17 trillion tokens that this would have been trained on here. Now, they do mention that for the smaller models, they're actually trained on significantly more tokens than that formula to improve the performance for a given inference budget in there. So that falls in line with things like the Llama 2 models, and we suspect also the Mistral models, which are trained beyond chinchilla scaling for their size. You can imagine, though, as you get to much bigger models, that becomes harder and harder to train for that ratio and large amount of tokens. Also, we don't know how they're measuring the tokens for the various multimodal inputs, being audio being video, I think it's safe to say that the number of tokens for those things may end up being a lot more than just what's going in there for the various text inputs, etc. So the nano models are actually pretty small. There are two of them, nano one being 1.8 billion parameters and nano two being 3.25 billion parameters. And it does seem that these are clearly made for mobile phones, for, you know, devices, etc. So these are created by distilling from the larger Gemini models to get things down. So if you're not sure of what distilling is, it's basically where you use a larger model to teach a smaller model with the goal of getting the smaller model to get as much ability as the larger model, but be significantly smaller. So we've seen this in examples with things like the ChatGPT turbo models. And you could imagine also the same with pretty much every large language model that is in production for scale at the moment is doing things like this. I think a lot of people would be surprised at how small some of the proprietary models actually are compared to the open source models. While the research versions of the proprietary models have been very big, when they actually put them into production, they're usually distilling it down into something much smaller that they can then serve on hardware at scale with good inference times, etc. So it's also really interesting to see that the nano models are 4-bit quantized for this. So I think this is one of the first times that we've seen the big companies go for these low resolution and quantized models. And it's something that certainly a lot of people have been doing research on. A lot of the open source models that people are using on their local computers are actually 4-bit versions or lower sometimes even. And while you do lose something in accuracy and precision with these, just the speed that you get from having a smaller model allows you to basically have faster inference and take up much less of a footprint than the full-size version of the model. So it's very interesting to see that Google's gone this way for the actual nano models. So let's jump in and look at some of the benchmarks here. So some of the figures here are going to be a little bit controversial in the things like the MMLU benchmark, where Google's reporting chain of thought at 32 examples, as opposed to 5-shot from GPT-4 here. And for quite a number of these, we don't have sort of apples to apples comparisons. I suspect for a variety of different reasons that perhaps Google's using more examples in their chain of thought testing. Also, some of the GPT-4 ones are actually being tested, I think, on supervised fine-tune models for things like the GSM 8K, etc. And then don't forget also that the GPT-4 data set probably had some contamination in relation to things like GSM 8K, which OpenAI reported in their GPT-4 tech report themselves. I do think it's really interesting to look at the benchmarks for the multimodality stuff here. Here we can see that the Gemini Ultra is clearly winning against GPT-4 in each of these different categories. They also have their annotation of these being pixel only, which makes me wonder, is GPT-4V using an OCR engine or something else on it that they suspect for this? They mention here that Gemini sets new state of the art across a wide range of text, image, and video benchmarks, clearly showing that it does have the ability to do this. You could argue that's not that surprising, considering that not long ago for NLP, people would have separate models for all the various different tasks. And now large language models have really taken over being able to do all of those tasks in one language model. So it's not surprising that this works on multimodal stuff as well. One of the clear takeaways from this, though, is that not only does Gemini do well with multimodal information, but it turns out that probably that the multimodal information actually helps it to do better on single modality information. So by having pictures and audio and videos in there, that's actually helping the model to get better at doing text-only tasks. So one of the key things that they talk about in their evaluation is the idea of that whether joint training of multimodalities has the ability to make a model that's strong in each of the domains as compared to separate models that are just sticking to single node domains. So one of the demos that I think is most impressive is the one that basically we can hear someone's voice talking to Gemini. So therefore, the model is taking in both audio input as well as visual input, no text input. This is not being transcribed and put into the model. This is going in as audio input in here. And we get to see that the model can do a whole bunch of different tasks of playing games, comparisons, being able to reason on pictures to work out different problems that it's given, etc. And even things down to like being able to predict what movie someone is acting out by showing the model a small video of them actually acting things out. It's actually very impressive. Let's have a look at some of these now.
You are trying to get me to find the paper ball under the cup. I accept the challenge. The cup to the left.
Nice.
Both objects are round and flat.
There you go.
Both are food. The orange is a healthier choice than the cookie. They are both examples of popular toys that have been enjoyed by children and adults alike for many years.
Give me some ideas for what I could make with this.
I see pink and green yarn. How about a dragon fruit? Or how about a green cake with a pink heart?
Okay, how about these colors? And maybe show me some animals.
Okay, now I see blue and pink yarn. How about a pig with blue ears? Or an octopus? Or a bunny with a pink nose?
Is this the right order?
No, the correct order is Sun, Earth, Saturn.
Based on their design, which of these would go faster?
The car on the right would be faster. It is more aerodynamic.
What movie are they acting out here?
I think they are acting out the famous bullet time scene from The Matrix.
Ooh, nice.
So as you can see there, those examples are very impressive of what it can do. I don't think the voice is actually being generated by Gemini or the sounds. I don't think it has actually audio out. Looking at the paper, they have audio in, video in, image in, text in, etc. But for the generation, I think it can only generate text and generate images. Still very impressive that it's able to do those things. So the Gemini suite of models is gradually rolling out in a number of different Google products. I think the Gemini Pro is already in Google Bard for a lot of countries around the world, as well as being incorporated into things like the Duet AI products and a number of other products. So starting on the 13th of December, people will be able to get access to the Gemini Pro model via Vertex and via an API system that they're going to roll out. And then the Gemini Ultra model is expected to arrive early next year for people to use. And interestingly, it looks like Google's also going to roll out a more advanced version of Bard that perhaps will be a paid service using the Gemini Ultra model. So that also looks very interesting to see what's going to happen there. Anyway, as always, if you've got any questions, please put them in the comments below. Let me know what you think of the Gemini release. I'll be certainly making some more videos of what you can do with the APIs and with the various models over the next few weeks or so. So look out for them. All right. As always, I'll talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.